online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Breaking into reality, the reality of reality TV. On Breaking in Reality, our guests will share with us how it happened for them. How did they break into reality? Also, insider tips on how to get on a reality TV show yourself. And I'm Sheila Conlon, casting director, producer of many long-running shows, such as Hell's Kitchen, Kitchen Nightmares, and also some very short-running shows, such as Utopia and I Want to Marry Harry. You can tweet me at ConlonGoTV. And this is Tim. Tim is with the Conlon Company. He's my development manager and producer. Tim's going to share with us gossip insider tips every week. And Tim Ferretti.
Hi, Sheila. I don't think we see each other enough in the office, do you? Good to be here today. Good to be here today with you.
Thank you. And your Twitter?
My Twitter is at ConlonCoTV as well. That's where you can tweet us questions throughout the show and thereafter.
Great. And our special guest today is Josh Harris from the Cornelia Marie.
Hey, you said it correct.
Yeah, and from the Deadliest Catch.
That is correct.
Welcome, Josh.
Well, thank you very much.
And what is your Twitter?
Well, my Twitter would be Josh Harris DC, I believe. You know, I don't use it very often, but I try to catch up on that stuff when I'm home. I'm gone 9 months out of the year, so bear with me.
So at least we know we've got something. We'll get something to you, right?
Yeah, of course.
Or you can tweet us and we'll get it to you.
Hey, that sounds like a deal.
So, Josh, tell us, breaking into reality. So how did it happen for you? Did reality find you, or did you find it?
Well, our job is a little off. You know, a lot of people die, and so the biggest mystery of life is death. And our boat got picked up by, you know, grabbing six dead bodies. That was our partner boat that sank. And, you know, everybody heard about it. So the guys that had the cameras came over and said, hey, if you see anything cool, you know, film it, and we'll give you some money. And then the show took off. It was supposed to be a one-hour special at midnight, and it got better ratings than their primetime stuff. So it just kind of continued on from there.
So basically they found you.
Yeah, but they found my dad and my brother, and then my dad told me that if I wanted to have a set of kahunas, I needed to come back to work and work for him. And so I did, and, you know, now we're 8 years later, and here I am. And it's kind of been a crazy ride.
No kidding, 8 years?
11 years on TV is what our show's been on. I've only been on the show for 8.
Wow. So, okay, so reality TV for you, like you said, it sort of found you and it found it through your dad. Did you have to go through any casting process, or did anybody interview you? How did it happen?
Basically, the way it happened is I showed up to work, and they said, how you doing? And I said, hey. And then that's when it all started. I didn't really have much of a choice. Sign this piece of paper, and then we're going to start filming you.
Okay, that's pretty amazing, because it usually doesn't happen that way for most people, or for how we do reality, since I've been doing it 15 years ago. So that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. How much ship experience had you had when your dad invited you back on?
I'm third generation fisherman, but I got sucked into a turbo diesel motor, just about sucked on my insides out through my left shoulder blade, so I had to take a year and a half off. It was kind of a really crappy deal. But I'm here back in full spirits, and I'm walking on both my feet, and I can use both my arms, so I'm really excited about that.
Oh my God. Well, I think the last time I saw you was at the Reality TV Awards.
Yes, indeed it was.
So Deadliest Catch won, what, how many awards?
We won 3. And so that was pretty good.
I mean, pretty good.
Won a lot of Emmys, won a lot of random awards, and it's kind of crazy to think that, you know, for a guy that didn't graduate high school, and that was like a punishment, was to go crab fishing, how would it all turn out now?
No kidding. That's not bad. You're a superstar. You're a reality star. You're famous.
It's so weird to hear, though. I just feel like, you know, I don't know. When I'm gone 9 months out of the year, when I come home, it's like, man, you know, people want to come up and give you hugs and do all this stuff. And, you know, I remember reading on the internet a bunch of what people were saying and stuff. Like, right now, I could be impregnating a girl in New York, and I don't even know about it, even though we're in the studio in L.A. You know, it's really weird how everything works out. And, you know, it's kind of different, you know, overall. But, yeah, here we are.
Well, you know, talking about that happening to you, you could be impregnating someone and you don't even know it. It's all about the fans, right?
Yeah.
You have crazy fans.
There is some crazy fans out there, you know. You just never know what you're going to get. And then somebody reads something on the internet, they automatically assume that it's got to be real.
Right, but we like the fans. For reality TV, that's sort of, you know, it's instant stardom, or, you know, that gives you ratings. And that's what helps, you know, reality TV grow. So you're pretty high up there on the mark. And Yahoo did a poll about the favorite reality personality, and your dad was listed. Yeah, tell me about that.
Yeah, I got favorite reality person or personality of all time. And so that was pretty cool. A lot of people voted for him. Our show's in 204 countries now, and I think it's number one in 179 of them. So we're doing okay. And it's kind of crazy to think that we have that much support. But, you know, I'm not a shining beacon of hope by any means. What you see is what you get. And, you know, so it's kind of like you guys, people that watch our show have watched me grow up. And if you think about it, when kids were watching it with their dads, now their dads watch it with their kids, which is really crazy.
What is it about your father that you think resonated so much with fans that years later of him being on TV, he still won a Yahoo TV poll, fan-voted poll?
My dad had a mullet. Everyone seemed to like that quite a bit. No, but he was just, you know, he was like the dog at the pound that you would see, and it looks super cute. So you take it home, and you're petting it, and you're like, man, I'm going to go get this dog some toys. You come back, it's pooped twice in your carpet, tore up your favorite couch, and you're like, what did I get myself into? But then it gives you that look with the sideways head turn and the big puppy dog eyes. That was my dad.
Oh, yeah, that's it. And also the show, and with, you know, even watching you on it, which I love watching you on it. I'm a fan.
Thank you.
I'm a fan. It's authentic. It's genuine. And to me, I started out in reality in the very beginning. And to me, it was an opportunity to give people a chance to, you know, ordinary people doing extraordinary things. And that's what your dad did. That's what all the guys that do on the show, what you do. And it's so great to see that unravel. And every day. I mean, it's the real deal. There's nothing scripted there, is there?
No. You know, we deal, the reason I think everyone loves our show is because we deal with common day problems that everybody else deals with. And so, you know, they get to watch the way that we encounter these problems and what we do, because there is no script. It's not like Mother Nature, can you resend that rogue wave? We weren't ready to film, re-kill these guys or re-rip his arm off or, you know, whatever it may be. And we deal with the same problems though that everyone else does. So it's just, you can relate to it. You know, it's not fluffed up. It's not like, excuse me, I didn't get this MAC makeup or my boob job got botched. It's, you know, we're really fighting for survival out there, and sometimes we don't make it, and it's been proven, you know. So it is what it is, but, you know, treat every day like a gift. And that's why we're always so happy and peppy and a little unorthodox in our decision making, but, you know, we're still here.
Well, good. No, I love that. And let's just do, you know, one little nice homage to your dad. I guess there were some beautiful artwork done with his ashes. Can you tell us about that?
Oh, we did a couple different things. You know, we took half of him, buried him with his mom, and then you know, we had this awesome fuel tank put together because he was a Harley rider, you know, and he you know, we just kind of dumped him off over near Priest Rock, which is a beautiful place because he always wanted to kind of be both places. So we said, to hell with it, we'll stick him both places. And you know, it was just a great gas tank Michael Valley had done up. The guy did all the Monster Garage stuff, and an amazing artist. And it was very moving, you know. We had a lot of people show up, like 10,000 people at his first wedding, or his first funeral. And as you can see.
Oh, wow. There it is there. Yeah.
No, it was quite amazing. I don't know how many hours he put into that, but it was definitely amazing. It was really cool. We stuffed it full of all sorts of things, you know, poker chips and this and that. He loved gambling. And he loved Harleys and he loved fishing. And he loved me and my brother.
Oh, my God. This is like my kind of guy.
He was
Harleys,
cool.
Fishing, poker I could do without. And I do love you. Well, I haven't met your brother yet, so we'll see.
He's an interesting little creature.
So let's get real.
Sure.
Let's get real with Josh. So now, I mean, how has reality TV helped you out? How's it changed your life?
Well, I never have a problem getting a date.
That's important.
That's a bonus, yes. And then,
Is there a line you use? Is there something? What do you do?
I just walk in. I'm kind of retarded looking, and so I just have that lost look when I come in, and then people are like, "I know you," and you know, it's very distinct. So it works out.
It works out in your favor to get the date? But is there a lot of pressure once you're on the date because you know you're the guy on TV or you?
I don't know. I drop it right down right then and there. Usually I'll go to an arcade and want to win tickets to buy the little trinket toy, you know, and it'll break before you even leave the place, but at least you get a story behind it. Turn into a giant child. Go-kart racing, occasionally long walks on the beach, cartwheels, high fives, hugs, you know, random stuff.
Random? But does any of it mean anything, or is it just standard for you?
No, I really like Disneyland, though. I really do. I'm terrified of rides. Heights really freak me out, so anything I can do to make myself look, you know, more like a child, I guess, in a sense. I love, you know, just being funny.
Oh.
A lot of laughing.
So are you dating now? Are you single?
I actually dated a chick for about 4 weeks, and then she broke up with me via text and said I didn't communicate well enough. So... Yeah, it got me too.
I was like, wait a minute. Broke up with you on text. Did you kind of like her?
Well, obviously, if I started dating her, yes. But
yeah.
I figure, you know, since I'm gone for so long, it's probably not wise to have a relationship because having a relationship with an answering machine isn't exactly fun.
How many months out of the year are you gone?
Well, this year coming up, I'm going to be gone probably 9 or 10.
Wow.
So, you know,
that's a lot.
Oh, yeah. No, so, you know, when it comes to the reality of having a relationship, that's not a relationship. That's called a prison sentence. And so,
yeah, it's a different show.
Exactly.
Yeah, right? That is a different show. That would be actually a pretty good show.
That's right. My boyfriend's in prison.
No, well, you know, at that point, it's just let's watch the ladies let depression set in and see what they do.
Right.
I mean, that would definitely be an interesting show.
So what do you think you'd be doing if you weren't on the show?
Well, that is a great question. Now...
Or you don't know, or maybe you don't. I mean, you have no idea because this obviously was destiny.
Yeah, you know, I'm third generation fisherman, so I really don't know. If I wasn't on the show, I'd still be fishing. I didn't graduate high school, but you know, I mean, yeah, I enjoy it. I'm always on the edge of my seat. Every day is different.
Did you ever think of something else to do? I mean, was there any other passion or dream that you had?
Well, I wanted to be a firefighter for a bit, and I was, and then that didn't work out very well. That's when I was 18. It's over at Station 4 in Glenwood Everett and Boeing Field. And then that lasted not too long. I mean, I got my ears burnt in the first actual house fire I went into. And for $32,000 a year, that wasn't cutting it. I could make that in 3 weeks of fishing. So
yeah.
I was like, if I'm going to go risk my life, let's make some money doing it. Chicks don't dig the poor guy. So, I mean, they dig heroes, don't get me wrong. But, you know, I like making money. I like cool stuff.
Do you make a lot of money fishing?
You can. Yeah, lately, not so much for me because the boat's been breaking down, catching fire. And, you know, our crab quota has been a little low. But that's all about to change. We've acquired just about 2 million pounds in quota, so we're one of the largest catching vessels out there. So it's going to be a really big deal coming up.
So I don't understand that. What do you mean? You acquired $2 million quota?
2 million pounds in quota.
Okay.
Like, the government comes out with this pie. We all own a percentage of the pie. You can rent other people's percentage of the pie. I went partners with a group of gentlemen, and, you know, because I couldn't do this on my own. We were flailing. And so I sold them a little percentage of my boat, and in turn, they brought over their quota. And so now we are going to be catching more crab than we know what to do with.
This is still the Cornelia Marie.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. Represent.
My dad would come down from where he's at, or come up from where he's at, and he would slap me the ugly slap.
Good.
And that's not pretty.
Okay, so let's say you weren't on Deadliest Catch.
Okay.
What other reality show would you, like, you know, reality's so big right now, would you try out for another reality show?
Well, you know, if there was a hot chick to go with it, I'd be Naked and Afraid. But I would probably get stuck with somebody that is nasty. So I would like to do, like, you know, in all reality, speed vision. I think that'd be cool.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
Go out and test cars. I really like driving fast.
How about Hell's Kitchen?
Hell's Kitchen's cute.
Can you cook?
Oh, I can cook very well. I'd probably start yelling at Gordon Ramsay and tell him he's off doing his thing. I think it would be interesting. I run a tight ship.
See, that's what Tim and I were talking about. That we're like, oh my God, if he wasn't already on a show, and if you could cook, trying to find out.
But you know what? I would challenge Gordon Ramsay to a kitchen that moved, like being on the ocean, and let's see how much stuff he can cook. And I'll tell you what, my meals would be perfect, and I'd be yelling at him, being like, "Come on, don't be a pussy. Let's do this." You know.
Oh, I bet. What's your favorite dish, or what's your best dish?
Depends. I like to make pastas from scratch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I absolutely love it, and they're pretty good. They're like an Italian-based pasta. I love spaghetti and meatballs. I have my own recipe for spaghetti and meatballs. But my favorite dish of all time, I must say, that gets the most reviews is deep-fried French toast.
Oh.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yum.
Don't threaten me with a good time.
Yeah.
I'm Josh. I like to party.
Stay the night with me, and you get French toast
That's
in the
right.
morning.
And sometimes I'll even stuff it for you.
Yum.
That's
oh, my
good.
God. All right, so I see a spinoff here. We can do this as, you know, your next breaking into reality, Josh's cooking show.
Yeah, I'll tell you what. We've come up with some pretty good stuff. I got this heart attack breakfast that's amazing. It's like you take a pound of sausage, ground sausage, crisscross bacon over the top of it, put another pound over that, crisscross bacon over top of it, roll it into a log. Then you put bacon over the top of that, cook it in the oven like you would cook a meatloaf. Then you take the top off, you know, and then you got to broil it, crisp the bacon on top, and then you cut up a bunch of wedges of potatoes, you know, season it, a little Italian seasoning, get some egg, you know, you can either do like, you make a base with this potatoes, you throw egg on it, scrambled, or you can do a sunny side up, and then stick a chunk of this loaf on top, and voila, you've got something that is more impressive than...
Oh my God, well, go to breakingintorealitytv.com for the recipe.
Okay,
we'll start putting all your recipes on there.
I've got some good ones.
Yeah, this is a good idea. It's a good idea. So what's your favorite reality show to watch?
My favorite reality show? Well, I'm going to have to say the Kardashians are out. No offense.
Why is that?
You know, just I actually like reality.
Real?
Yeah.
Authentic?
There's not too many out there right now that aren't scripted, you know, so it's kind of like, I think we're one of the only ones that aren't scripted. I can't really think of any of the other ones that...
No, I agree with you, because that's part of why we're doing this show, too, breaking into reality and really giving, you know, the basis of what it takes to get in, you know, and we're talking about family business. Your family business is on a reality show. So other people out there that have family businesses and are thinking about breaking into reality, how would you do it? You know, and do you want to do a scripted type thing, or do you want it to be authentic?
You want to hear something crazy?
Yeah.
My hometown, Monroe, Washington, that's where, like, the hometown of Derry Gould is, Cowtown. Five of us grew up together and ended up on different reality shows. Isn't that crazy? Like, we have one of my best friends, he's on Bering Sea Gold, and it's Cody Moen, grew up with me, lived at my house, and we had another guy by the name of Josh as well. He got into American Stuntmen. And then there was Dr. Evil, or what is it, Dr. Something's, whatever, another stuntman show. And one of our other buddies was on that. And then we had this girl named Liz that was on, was an American Runway Model thing. And we all lived together in the same house for a bit, and that was kind of crazy. But we're all from Monroe, went to school together and everything, and just as our lives progressed, got on different shows. And then we had one guy from that Logger show, too. So it was kind of crazy.
That's
all
bizarre.
From, like, a 1,000-person high school, all of us got on all these different shows.
Well, for people out there who are watching who think they would want to be on a reality show, What advice could you give them? How long did it take you to warm up to the idea? When you were first approached, were you scared? Were you nervous? And were there things that you know now that would have made that experience a little easier or made you more prepared for it?
If you get on a reality show, make sure it's scripted because that's where you make money.
Okay.
You put a SAG.
All right.
Number two, if you feel like selling your soul to the devil, then do it. It's amazing. It's at the end of the day, it just depends on what you like. But for me, I can be myself, so I'm no different on TV than I am right here. Not necessarily the shining beacon I hope everybody expects, but hey,
Oh, you are.
Diamond in the rough, right? It's just, everybody's wanting wills on things. I'd recommend doing scripted because at least you're under SAG laws, I suppose.
And no, I don't think it's not under SAG laws, but you're right. I think you said it. It's you sell your soul. I mean, it's a deal. It's a deal you make. It's like, okay, this is what we're going to do, and we're going to tell you how to do it. And if you're willing to put it all out there completely on it, put me in a cage and tell me to bark like a dog, I'll do it, and you'll get paid, $3 million an episode. So great.
Well, that would be awesome if it worked that way. Shit, I wouldn't have to worry about fishing then. Man, $3 million an episode. I'll tell you what, I would be laughing all the way to the bank. I would bark like a dog. But the reality is that doesn't happen.
Right.
And everybody thinks there's all this big money. Well, corporate controls everything, and they take the big sponsorships and everything like that, and then they tell you who you can talk to, who you can't talk to, and what you can do and what you can't do. And so, it's different. Like for us, it started off and it was a small show that turned into this worldwide event, and no one ever saw it coming, and our ratings are up by 16%. So it's like even after 11 years, they still want more, which is quite odd, But what you get with us, though, is authenticity. We're real people, and you get to see our day-to-day life, which is, pretty bizarre.
Well, yeah, which I think is what people want. I mean, because I know from the beginning, watching real people do real things and competing against each other, that was exciting. And it was relatable, and it gave people, courage to go, I could try that, or I could do that. Or, looking at you guys, that's very heroic, and you're out there, facing danger. That, to me, is what reality TV is. And
what's interesting is in Deadliest Catch, nature or Mother Nature is almost a character in and of itself that cannot be scripted and it cannot be produced.
She's evil. heartless, you know what. And, it's it's painful.
And shipmen have a different relationship with the idea of nature than most people in this world.
I'll tell you what. I wish she was nice, but unfortunately, she's terrible. That's another story for another time.
So what else is in it for you right now? Because you're still going strong on reality. You're still going to be on a show. You still have the boat. But what about, I always talk about building your brand. Building a brand, that's what reality TV is a lot for family businesses. Is there anyone who's an expert who has something that they want to build? So at this point, for you, are you thinking about that? Do you have ideas of what you want to do to build a brand?
That is a great question, and I do not have a great answer. I mean, I would love to. There's a lot of things I would love to do. Obviously, fishing is such a challenge for me. I'd like to see, other aspects of the industry. I think that'd be a lot of fun.
You must get approached. Haven't you gotten approached by a million people to do something?
Yeah, there's been a lot of different, things that obviously I can't do due to the contract I'm in. But, if I go to do anything else outside of this, it would hurt the validity of the show. And so that is something that, is kind of important. That's why people watch us, is because we're real people and we're not actors. And
right. You feel like you're constricted right now because of the contractual agreement?
Yeah. I got to continue doing my job, which I love doing my job. But, that's the reason that it's the hardest job in the world, and we all want to get out of it eventually. But for right now, it suits me well. When this is done, the show's done, and I feel like I'm done fishing. I've accomplished my goal of getting the boat out there and making sure that it runs and we make money and doing what I set out to do for myself. Then maybe I'll have an opportunity to do other things, and that would be awesome. It'd be a lot of fun just to try something new. And what I go back to fishing? Probably, you know, but for right now, I think if I have the opportunity to do something, I might do it.
I mean, I kind of see, you know, Calvin Klein model billboards.
No, that's cute.
There you go. Something like that, you know.
So I have a question for all of our enthusiasts out there who might want to get into this line of work. What is the secret to a good hook throw?
Good hook throw. Well, first off, being able to be right-handed.
Oh, yeah.
I'm left-handed, and so I had to reteach myself how to throw right-handed. And other than that, being strong and stupid. That's about it.
Strong and stupid. Okay.
Why? What is this? Well, the strong gives you the oomph?
I got to think about this. Everybody hears about these man-of-war jellyfish, right? Yeah, we get like 15 pounds worth for every knot that is on a crab line. There's usually four or five of those. So when those hit the block, that's the thing that pulls the pot in. It explodes over your face. So by the end of the day, you've been stung so many times by these jellyfish that your eyes swell shut. So when I say you got to be tough, you know, that's one of the things. And, you know, failure is saying, oh, I hurt. Oh, I can't see. It's like, no, you just keep going. Like, my eyes have swollen shut multiple times from that, and it's not fun. It's like 50 bees stings every time one of those hits your face. Jeez. And if you whine about it, then you're a whiner. It's like, get out of here.
Wow.
And you lose all respect. You break a finger, you duct tape it up, and away you go. You don't bitch about it. You know, it's just consistently, you know, being tough and stupid. I mean, that's what fishing is. I should have stayed in school. You know, so to all the kids out there, or people that are thinking about wanting to be crab fishermen, go back to school. My job really does suck.
Yeah, that's intense.
It's a little weird. Not for the week.
Yeah, no kidding. Are you ready to go try it, Tim?
I would give it a whirl. I think it's a lot of learning on the job, though. I might be a little behind the boat.
If you mess
up. Well, so to speak.
Yeah, if you mess up, you're killing yourself or the guy working next to you.
Yeah, and that's... And most people start younger, right? I mean, it's like you're something you're brought up in.
How old are you now?
I mean, do I have to say... No, 30.
You're 30.
I'm 30.
In crabbing years, you're like 75.
Yeah, that's what I figured. You know. Yeah.
Oh, wow, yeah, you're retired.
I'm retired. I'm near retirement, huh?
Pretty much, yeah.
I do have a question, though, about something piggybacking off what Sheila said. So many people go into reality TV for branding purposes, for maybe elevating their profile or their company's profile. Does that apply to... being on The Deadliest Catch, does that have a same net effect on the recognition of Cornelia Marie and your boat? Part of that kind of touches on like the landscape of how your business works, I guess.
Well, you know, like the bigger companies control a lot of the stuff, so we don't get that opportunity like everyone else would, you know. And they keep this show authentic. You know, if all of a sudden we show up and our boat looks like a NASCAR, you know, it's not gonna be working out too well, you know. And that's for the validity of the show comes in, and they've done a good job in receiving a lot of money for doing that. They have, and because if we made a bunch of money, you got to think about this. There's a really big storm. Be like, oh, we're not going out in that. We make too much money. Like, I don't want to get anybody hurt, you know. But if they pay us just a little bit, and we're not allowed to do these big endorsement deals, well, then it's like we still have to go out and fight for that money because that is our main source of income, you know. And it's not like that's what I'm saying. I wish I got $3 million an episode. I'll tell you what, I would be tickled pink.
Right, right.
But I guarantee I wouldn't be going out into big waves and risking my guys' lives, you know. And so that's, you know, a very fine line on that. And that's just the way it works. But, you know, we're still here and everybody's still watching because we still have to go out and earn our money.
Well, you're still doing the real thing. I mean, it's like you can't change that.
No.
That's something that we often talk about in casting is stakes. And that's kind of what he's touching on, is that the stakes must exist for the show to have that same pulse and life.
Well, and everybody would know if we were making all this money and we're not trying as hard, it would be the deadliest flop then. You know, I remember reading on Google, someone was like, I know the real story behind it. It's all green screened in California. I was like, man, God, that would be great. I would love
it. Yeah, we could do that.
An 8-hour like film sesh and then go out to the beach, do some surfing. I think that'd be fantastic. But...
Now, are the shooters and the production team also in the line of fire and danger? Right. I mean,
every second we're up, they're up. Every step of the way we go, you know, they go. And especially when something bad happens, they got to be right there to cover it. And, you know, sometimes it gets really uncomfortable with them, like an argument breaks out in the boat. And then they got to hop in and ask questions while this argument's going on and someone's getting ready to, you know, throw blows, you know, and that can turn into a really bad situation. You know, a lot of camera guys get punched during the season, you know, because you're crammed onto a little boat with eight or nine dudes and everyone's got a problem. Say somebody's wife cheats on them and they get a call home and all of a sudden they're in a bad mood and then somebody else's, you know, daughter's in the hospital at the same time. And then we're working long hours. Our average work day is 36 hours on, 4 hours off. You know, and you're pushing something that weighs as much as a car, you know, and when that boat lifts up, that's a lot of weight. That's like four times that weight, you know, and if somebody's mind isn't in the game, then someone's going to get really hurt or they're going to kill themselves or the guy working next to them. Yeah. So then there's a guy like me that's got to come in and rationalize all this stuff, be their mother, their father, you know, their coach, their therapist, everything. And it's very, very difficult. And and then you got the camera guys. And they're like, hey, dude, so how do you feel right now?
Like, how do I feel? Over here. Yeah.
Do you see what's going on? How do you think I feel?
Yeah, this is so crazy because everything you just described is what we dream of for creating shows. I mean, literally, it's like if, you know, people try, or people, producers, have literally tried to create those moments to happen. God, wouldn't it be great if, you know, the daughter was in the hospital, or the wife cheated, or we could do this, you know, and all of those great things that push all our buttons, but it's actually happening to you guys.
Yeah. No, and then we're confined. You know, it's
right,
not like, oh, I'm going to go home and go check on this. I got to leave work right now. You're stuck. We're 300 miles out, you know, where it's not fit for man nor beast. And that's the only thing that's on your mind for 36 hours straight. I mean, you imagine how people must feel. And it's not. And then you want to call home to get answers, and no one's answering the phone. And then you got to get back out on deck. And all the whole time you're out there, you're just thinking about, man, what is going on at home? And you can't stop work.
Right,
you know,
right.
You keep going.
God, that's crazy. So it's a strange parallel because in the world of reality, you know, for our shows like Hell's Kitchen or Survivor, even American Idol, you know, you get sequestered. So everybody knows, so as you're going to go onto the show, part of the deal, you have to go away and stay for however many weeks that you're in the game. You don't get to call home. You don't get to talk to, you know, any of your friends. You can't read the newspaper. This is like, you guys have, like, created the exact model of how everything else has been shot and done. But you're actually, that's the real
deal.
That's
the life. That's the life we live. It's not even a model. It's just the way
right.
that life is.
Right.
And even in those extreme conditions and unique conditions to Deadliest Catch, there are still, like, universal stories that are being told. And that's what's been interesting about your and your family's arc in the story and what you guys have, you know, what they've told about you and what the viewers have seen. But so what is your proudest moment on the show?
My proudest moment on the show? Getting the boat back, probably.
Yeah.
I mean, that was, everyone said that it was impossible to get the boat, and much less even if I did get it, it would be impossible to make it a successful operation, because the last, I don't know, seven or eight boats that have tried to come in have all failed. And those guys were guys that have been in the industry for 20 plus years as skippers, they had quota, and it just didn't work out. So for me to do this with nothing and beg, borrow, and do whatever I had to do to get everything together and get people to believe me, you know, and back me up, you know, just for the little favors of littlest things, just in getting bait or fuel or whatever, you know, it's all come together. And now after years of, you know, working my tail off and getting to this point, now we have like the largest quota out of the whole Bering Sea for a catcher boat that's owned it privately, and like we're actually going to be doing really well. I mean, we just renovated the whole boat, made it better and more technologically advanced than it's ever been, and it's one of the most technologically advanced boats now out there. Safest, largest. Yeah, and then there's little old me. Hi. And I'm going to be driving it, and the youngest skipper in the Bering Sea. So, you know, there's a lot to what's going on, and it's a lot of pressure, and I'm scared. But then I know what I'm doing, and I'm going to get out there, and I'm going to do it.
Yeah, that was a cool moment when they brought and you came back and setting the Cornelia Marie back on the sea. And the guy who was training you said, he was going to train you to be skipper, he said, you know, there's a fine line because he owns the boat and he's going to be skipper now too. Mm-hmm. Was that an interesting process to be trained to fill that role as well?
It's quite weird.
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, during that learning process, it was kind of like, you know, nobody can yell at me. I can yell at them, but is it right for me to yell at them because they can't yell back at me? You know, and because I'm the owner too. So it's like, it was really odd, you know, and it was a very interesting learning curve. But, you know, now that things are starting to get on point and I've been upstairs for long enough, it's like, we'll see what happens, you know. I want to do everything the safe way and make sure, it's, you know, I don't kill anybody and, you know, knock on wood, wherever it may be.
Anywhere.
You know, that's my goal, safety first, you know, always, and do things as professional as I possibly can.
So who are you going to bounce things off of? I mean, if you're just up there, you're the captain, you're the only one making decisions, do you get to confer with anyone?
I'm going
to
call you.
Good, yeah.
Great. No, I give you a call, give me a call. You know, what should I be doing at this point?
That's right.
Don't tell anybody.
Okay, Josh, listen, this is what we're going to do.
How many camera guys are up there right now?
Yeah,
okay,
right.
This is what I think should happen. You know, it's, you just have to go on your own instinct, and that's what it's about, being a captain, you know, is what makes the guys good, the greats, you know, is you just go off your own instinct, and, you know, probably 8 out of 10 times you strike out. I mean, for every full pot we pull, you have to pull 100 blanks first. So every time you see all these guys pulling these full pots up right out the gate, yeah, that's BS.
Ah.
You know? So, I mean, very rarely does that ever happen.
But, right, right.
I mean, we've been known to do it, though.
What is it like when you get a pot full of, do you guys call them dirty crabs?
Yeah, that's the biggest disappointment. That's like when you get the really big Christmas present, and it's like a thing of Tic Tacs in it. It's like, you know, that huge 6-foot box, and it's got the cool bow, and you're like, oh, and then you get up there, and you unravel it, and it's really light, and you're like, what? You cut into it, and then it's a little box, and then inside a little box is a thing of Tic Tacs. You want to talk about a letdown.
Yeah, right. Oh, no.
I can give you another analogy, but I don't think it's appropriate.
You know, I actually think Sheila, of all people I know, could survive on that boat.
You do?
Yes.
Hey, she is. Yeah.
She is tough.
Yeah, I'm not here to argue with that. Yeah, it's her birthday today, though, too.
That's right.
It's your birthday.
Yeah, yeah.
Turning 29. I'm so proud of you.
I know, 29. I can't wait for 30 next year. This is it. My last year, the 29th. No, you know, I think I could. I grew up in Minnesota, and I grew up fishing. I can, you know, I can catch it. I can put the worm on. I can put that worm on. I can catch it, and then I can take it up to the table, and I can gut it and clean it.
Really?
The only thing I can't do is cook it. I'm not that great at cooking.
Oh, hey.
But then I can eat it.
I'm right. You like fish?
Love fish.
See, fish is bait to me. That's why I hate my friends. Like, hey, you want to go get sushi? I'm like, yeah, that's bait. Like, you know.
Oh, that's right. I never thought about that.
Yeah. You know how much fish I have to kill a year just in order to catch those stupid crab? No, they're very, very important crab, I guess.
Right, they're not stupid.
No.
Yeah,
remember, I only catch crab on the ocean and not on land. Nobody likes that guy. So I just have to add that in there. People start to, that could be listening or like, what's this guy talking about?
Right. What is that?
Mm-hmm.
No, but it's, I don't know. I would try it.
That would be interesting. I would give you about 15 minutes.
But I heard, too, there's a new girl on a boat, right? Isn't there somebody, the new greenhorn or something?
Yeah, I think Keith brought a green or a girl out. I just met her for the first time a couple weeks ago, and she's been a fisherwoman for a long time doing salmon stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard she did okay from some people, and then you know, other people, it was like, meh, you know.
Is it kind of like women in the military? Do they belong there?
It's just, you know, the upper body strength, you know, it's like women can push around pots, you know, because they have a lot of leg power, but, you know, 60% of the deck work is lifting 70 to 80 pounds per arm, and you do that for 36 hours straight, 36 to 90 hours straight, and you'll watch people crack real fast. And so, you know, women aren't known for a lot of upper body strength, and if they are known for it, they're usually got a bigger beard than me, and their name is Helga.
Right. So, and they're what?
Their name is Helga.
Oh, yeah. And they're from Norway, or Germany. Yeah.
Wherever that's just big women. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, Tim, I don't know. Maybe I should try it. 15 minutes, though?
That's what you give me. 15 minutes. I think 15 minutes would be appropriate. I could see you out there dressed up like a little rubber ducky. And you'd watch one of those waves. It's about 40, 50 feet. It would suck your hat right off your head, and you'd just watch it go curling
up. I'd probably go flying into the
wave. Can't
the
you bring her heels?
Yeah. That would be entertaining. Right. Let's make some TV.
That's right. Heels on a boat. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Heels on a boat.
Maybe once you're on the dock. When you're pulled in, we could do that.
Touche.
Yes, exactly. So what do we have next, Tim? What is on our agenda for breaking into reality?
Well, now I think it's time to hear some tips from you on this kind of general topic of family businesses on TV. Okay. And what makes for a good subject matter. And, of course, we'd love you to get your input. Sure. On how you would advise people who are looking to do this sort of thing.
Right, and we sort of touched on that a little bit, mm-hmm. Earlier, but it is so different. But I truly believe your type of family business, I mean, to me, that's what I'm looking for. I want the real, authentic, I want to be able to capture what's happening at that moment, not, oh, let's do this over here, or let's move over here, now we restage that. And this. And most people think, because they have a family business and there's some drama, or this one doesn't get along with this one, that all of a sudden it's like we should be on TV. And I always, I get the phone calls, you get the phone calls. It's like, no, it has to be more than that. Yeah. It definitely has to be more. And some of my tips, if you're thinking about it, to break into reality with a family business, I mean, number one is uninhibited. You have to, and every single person in the business, and you know this really well, you have to know that no matter if the cameras are rolling or not, you have to let it all hang out.
Yeah.
Everything. That means your personal life, what's going on in the business, what are you making, every single thing has to be an open book. Mm-hmm. And you can't hide, like, oh, today I'm not going to talk about this, or, I'm not going to get up today and go to work. No, you have to just let everything hang out, right?
That's correct. And that's one of the hard parts. It's like, a lot of times we'll go out in public and people ask me about my past, and what happened when my dad died and stuff. And it's like, the drug use throughout my family and this and that, and it's like, I talk openly about that stuff because, well, we just wrote a book, not too long ago, the Captain Phil Harris book, and that pretty much states everything in it, and talked about everything we did. And people are like, you shouldn't say that to strangers. I'm like, well, you don't get is that it's already been said, and it's been said to hundreds of millions of people, so it's not like it's a big shocker, right. And then a lot of times, take the punches that come with it, though. So say you do get on reality TV, and, people have their own ideas. If you don't shake someone's hand right, or you give somebody a hug, and then they're like, they think that you're in love with them, and they're like, okay, take my number, and you're like, no, I'm cool. All of a sudden, on the internet, you're somebody that has done something amazing, and you wake up in the morning, and people are writing all sorts of stuff about you, and you were sitting here, and people in New York are shaking hands with me. When it comes to family businesses, though, it's like, with ours, it works because we started early on. We're one of the pioneer shows for, jobs and TV.
Right, right.
And, we have a lot of death and mayhem and a huge budget for being able to capture all this stuff. A lot of times people try, everyone's kind of abused this whole job thing from walking pets. I mean, there's a pet walking show now.
Yeah.
It's like, what?
How exciting is that?
This dog just took two dumps in one block. I mean, there's the whole episode. It's like, what is going on? And it's kind of just turned into something else. And then you get the shows that are reality-based, but they're scripted so hard and it's so bad, it just kind of gives a bad name to it, to reality TV in general, And so I think that...
I mean, the other ones that sort of worked is Pawn Stars. That's a family business. Mm-hmm. You really see what they're doing day to day.
It's factual, though, too.
People are coming in. They're doing it. It's the cast of characters that are buying and selling. And then they just do what they do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Duck Dynasty guys.
That one lasted. Is it still even going?
It is still going. Mm-hmm. It is still going.
Just not, yeah.
And that one was strange. It's like, if they just would have let them be who they were.
I think that would have been a really cool show.
I do, too.
When you watch him walk in, he's like, so what's going on today? And then they're like, I was like, man, that is so scripted.
Yeah, it was also a lie. I mean, it was straight up. They were putting them in the camouflaged, crazy outfits when they actually wear polo shirts and shorts, in their day-to-day. So it's like, to me, it's like just... doing what they do and in where they live, there's going to be interesting stuff to see. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So it's like, why make it something that's not?
Yeah, well, you know what? It made a lot of money. You know,
yeah,
I mean,
it did.
And they did too.
Because it was gimmicky.
All their products that they had out there probably soared. You know, so I mean, from a marketing standpoint, I guess that was a big success.
Yeah, it was a gimmick. It made the money. But then I think now I think the audience feels lied to a little bit. You know, it's kind of like, or duped. It's like, wait a minute. What happened here?
It got a little weird towards the end.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The beard thing came back. It's still here, apparently. You know, I've been noticing that a lot. But
yeah. And then, you know, the other one, like, I'm going to say it wrong. The Duggars?
Duggars.
I always say it wrong.
No, I remember hearing something about this group of people. Something weird happened recently or something.
Now, that's not a family business, but it sort of is.
It's the family.
It's the family because they have, like, 21 kids.
What?
19
kids.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like from the same couple?
Yes. They belong to what's called Quiverful, which is like a religious sect.
That chick trying to ever get a date. Oh my God.
So yeah, so that's sort of a happened. But you know, there's crazy stuff that happened.
Push
on that
19 day. Kids out of one person?
Yep.
Yep.
But viewers must come up to you and think they know you a lot about you. They don't look at you as a stranger.
Yeah.
Oh, like.
He's on the 19th. That was a segue.
That
right?
was a really interesting segue.
Wow, that's his own talk show from there. I mean,
down in what, Tennessee, show. Kentucky?
Yeah, right. So going back into breaking into reality and the tips, that I just blew his mind. Well, the other thing is relatable. You know, you have to be relatable. So if it's a business, like you guys, it's not completely relatable to people that they're out there on a big fishing vessel and doing it, but it's relatable in a sense that they know about it. It's a craft. It's a job.
Well, I think the main thing is the outreach we've got is from the same problems. Like everyone this day and age is having problems with, you know, family members that get addicted to drugs or a parent dying or, you know, like tough situations, you know, being put into a position before you're actually possibly ready for it, you know, and what do? Where do you get the strength from? You know, how do you figure out how to believe in yourself? All these things are common day problems that everyone has. And it seems to be every year that goes by, more and more people are getting addicted to random substances that are tearing each other's lives apart. And, you know, especially significant others or people who are dying around you, you know, and it's like, you know, as technology has advanced, we have become less social on a lot of aspects because we can look everything up on our phones. We don't have to talk to anybody. We just get online, look up YouTube.
Right.
And so it's like, you know, dealing with problems. We're still in the dinosaur age way out there, and so we have to deal with things head on. You know, and a lot of people don't know how to do that anymore.
Yeah.
You know,
no,
it's like
you're
I'll
right.
send a text, and a text is emotionless. We deal with things head on. I yell at my brother, he yells at me. I yell at my guys, or somebody else yells at me, and it's just raw emotion that's head on, and you know, a lot of people are losing that this day and age, and they don't know how to deal with it.
No, you're right. Those are great things that are relatable, because if you're going through a divorce, or you know, because it's really happening, so people want to see that. That's what they're drawn into. Even the dating shows, even the competition shows, it's like, okay, I could do that, or I've been through that, or I felt that way. No, that's a good one. The other one's characters, personality. I mean, you have to have an opinion. You have to be, have conviction for what you're doing and what you say. Can't be a pushover.
Yeah.
You know, like we do Kitchen Nightmares with Gordon Ramsay, and I tell the restaurant owners, it's like, well, if you're going to be a pussy and just say yes to anything that Gordon says, I go, why do I want you on the show?
Yeah.
Why does he want to help you? He doesn't want to help someone who's just going to roll over.
Yeah.
He wants to know that you know, you're struggling for your business, you're afraid of losing it, but you know what you want. It's yours. You got to own it. So it's that, you know, people to stand up and not be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Then what's the other thing? Oh, the journey. You know, what are we going to see? The struggles on the way, you know, because if you're starting a business, where do you want to end up? You want to end up with the biggest crab load, right?
Yes.
Coming in. So that's your...
Well, now it's just that, you know, the fact is where do I want to be? I want to be successful in being able to catch this crab. You know, it's taken me years and years and years now to get to the point where I'm at. Never thought it would happen, actually. I've gone and exceeded what I thought I could do at my best level. And now... biggest thing is, can I actually follow through and do it? Because now this could be the biggest flop ever, you know?
Right, and that's the stakes. Mm-hmm. There has to be some sort of stake, and you have to be willing to fail, succeed, or try.
With this specific situation, if I fail, then four people are going to be broke in a joke. My kids' kids will be broke. You know, it's like, that's how bad this will be.
Well, you're not going to fail.
No, I don't fail.
No, I'm going to come and help you.
Oh, well, thank you. I told you, in my time of need, I'm phoning a friend.
15 minutes from me, I will be there.
There's going to be a little red button, and I'm going to hit that button. I'll be like, I got to make that executive call.
Good, good, good. All right, so I think we have to start into, well, I did. We also.
Well, before that,
yes?
I had a quick sudden death trivia question, so let's.
Which I love.
Let's see what you both know about our subject matter today.
Oh.
My question is, how much does one crab pot weigh?
Oh, wait a minute. I'm not going to know that.
Now, does this have line in it, or is it just a crab pot?
With line in it. That, yes, with line in it. That's the one I know.
Well, of course you're going to know that. I don't know that. All right, I'm going to guess. I'm going to say, because you sort of said something earlier, 65 pounds.
65 pounds. That's as much as a buoy weighs. That's cute.
She's almost really, there, right? She's warm.
Yeah, oh, shit, I'm really off. Okay. Well, that's it.
All right, your turn.
About 1,100 pounds.
Oh, okay. I'm way off.
And how about without line and buoy?
About 800.
Ding, we don't have a sound effect. Ding, 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 ding.
Yeah.
Both were correct. That's exactly 800 pounds without the lines and buoys. And then with line and buoy, it is 1,100 pounds. So these are, if you're thinking visually, this is those huge, giant things filled with crabs that they're pulling up. Off the boat.
Size of a car.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Yes. Well, I didn't know that one. Okay. Since you threw out a question, all right, I'm going to throw one out to you, too.
Oh.
All right, so can either of you, there's two questions. What was the first reality show I ever did?
Survivor? No, maybe?
Nope.
Okay.
I mean, do you want me to say the right answer? Because I know it.
All right, yep, there it is.
It's Bachelorettes of Alaska.
Now that would have been an interesting one.
Yeah,
we could have been perfect for that.
You would have been fantastic on that one. Oh my gosh. Well, I think we're getting ready to wrap it up. That was quick already. Oh my gosh. So if you think, or if you have any questions, or if you want to break into reality, send us an email at
TROTV. At theconlincompany.com.
Great. Send us all your emails and
tweet us at conlincotv.com, Instagram us at conlincotv, and Facebook us at theconlincompany.
So thank you so much. Yeah, that was really impressive.
And our website is trortv.com and theconlincompany.com.
All right. And yeah, tweet us to find out who our guest will be next week. And we want to thank you, Josh, for being with us. And we look forward to seeing you on the big screen.
Oh, hey, I'll be there eventually.
Thank you, Josh.
And remember, this is Breaking Into Reality, and we want to know what your story is and why you want to break into reality. We're here to help. See you next week.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.